أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي كان موجودا قبل حدوث الأشياء ويبقى بعد فناء الأشياء، تفرد بالأولية والقدم ووسم كل شيء ما عداه بالفناء والعدم، كما قال عز شانه: كل شيء هالك إلا وجهه وكل نفس ذائقة الموت، وقال: كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. سبحان من لا يخفى عليه اختلاف النيات ولا يعذب عنه معاصي العباد في الخلوات. سبحان الله الذي منه خلقته العباد وإليه المعاد، فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يره، ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يره. نشهد أن لا إله إلا هو الملك الذي لا ينازع في ملكه ولا يضاد في حكمه، يعذب من يشاء بما يشاء كيف يشاء، ويرحم من يشاء بما يشاء كيف يشاء. تعذيبه المسيئين عدل وعفوه وتفضل. ونشهد أن محمدا سيد المرسلين وخير المبشرين والمنذرين، صلى الله عليه وآله الهداة المهديين، من ركب سفينتهم نجا واهتدى، ومن تخلف عنها ضل فغرق وهوى. أوصيكم عباد الله بالاعتصام بالتقوى، فإنه حبل متين وأروة الوثقى. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه تبارك وتعالى في محكم كتابه ومتقن خطابه: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فلولا كان من قرون من قبلكم أولو بقية ينحون عن الفساد في الأرض. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلى على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم. First of all, as is the requirement, as you know, regarding the first khutbah of the Friday prayers, to remind myself and to remind you all regarding our duty of taqwa. And that Imam Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu salam, says that this taqwa is the one that is going to be the currency that would benefit me in the journey to the hereafter. So, continuing a theme that you've been hearing about, I decided to speak about a particularly important matter regarding community, and which is referred to in this verse of the Holy Quran. This verse is verse number 116 of Surah Al-Hud, which is the 11th Surah of the Holy Quran. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that why is it that there were not among the generations before you people who possessed understanding? And what did they do? يَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْفَسَادِ فِي الْأَرْضِ. They used to prevent people from creating fasad, from mischief on the earth. So this verse gives us an indication and an instruction regarding something particularly important. And that is that in order for a society to progress, in order for a community to progress, there needs to be a group of people from amongst that society, from amongst those people, who have understanding and wisdom. This is the first thing. There has to be a group of people from every society, from every group of people who have understanding and wisdom. And in light of that understanding and wisdom, they are able to protect society from, and that community from, destroying its own self. And so long as there are this group of people who exist in society who call out the wrong and who try to prevent it from affecting the people, then that society, that community is protected and saved to a certain degree from disintegration altogether. So this group of people, what their job, what their role in society is to counter that facade, that mischief, by positive and informed dialogue, discourse. That if there's wrong happening in society, it's not sufficient for me to say that this is wrong. That is the first step, to acknowledge that whatever is happening is a problem. You know, to acknowledge the problem is halfway to the solution of the problem. But that acknowledging it, or to saying that this is a problem, is not sufficient. In fact, it could in some ways be worse, that if I'm just coming here and telling you these are the problems without any solutions, then it would lead people to be more depressed and more pessimistic about that society. So it has to be countered with not just the solutions, but it has to be countered with a positive message, a positive way of informing people. As you know, this is something that's very common in this part of the world, particularly those of you who work with young people, for example, even in the workplace, even in schools. The message is that even when you want to say something negative, you put a positive spin on it. You try and deliver that message with something that ends on a positive note. So that's the first responsibility, first job of this group of people who call out the evil in society, who call out the wrongs in society, who identify the problems and say that this is a problem. If everyone stays silent, if everyone says, for example, that this is not my problem, this is not something that's affecting me, that also, number one, is a problem, but it's also a symptom of something else. And that's something that we have to acknowledge as well. That if I stay silent about something, anything that is wrong, and I know that it's wrong, and I'm staying silent about it, or not that I'm staying silent about it, I have the ability to stay silent about it. That if I stay silent about it, if I don't say anything about it, it's not going to affect me. Then I have to acknowledge my privilege on that issue. I have to acknowledge the fact that I am privileged, that this particular issue is not affecting me, therefore I can stay silent. And that other people who don't have that privilege, whatever that privilege might be, whether that is the privilege of somebody who's standing up here, or it's the privilege that's to do with economic privilege or social privilege or social status or prestige, whatever it might be. But I acknowledge that I have that privilege in order to remain silent, that if I remain silent, it will not affect me. So I have to acknowledge that before I think that because it's not affecting me, I can stay silent. No, because that's not an option. That I have to, at least, at the very least, be able to acknowledge that it's wrong. And beyond that, I have to be part of the solution, because if I'm not part of the solution, then I'm part of the problem. Recite salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. In this regard, you'll recall that even in the holy month of Ramadan, when I had the opportunity to deliver the sermon, I mentioned this point. I mentioned it before. Those of you who heard me at Husseiniyah, I've mentioned this before. But it's worth mentioning again. And that is that with regards to society, with regards to community, whenever we speak about this, we also have a privilege in this regard, because we can put the blame or the responsibility on somebody else. Oh, the Maulana should do this, or the committee should do this, or so-and-so should do this. But question is, what am I doing? What is my responsibility? What do I need to do? Right? Whenever we talk about community and society are made up of individuals, made up of families. So it's my responsibility as an individual and as a member of a family to make sure that I as an individual am doing my part, and I as a family am doing my part. And if I do that, then automatically society would improve. Automatically society is not an abstract concept that's made up of something else. Society is made up of the same individuals that you and I and all of us are. Now, the interesting term that's used in this verse is ulul baqiyya, the people who possess, that's translated here as people who possess understanding, but in reality, those who possess that which remained. And this is important, because it's used in the way that it's used in the Arabic, in this verse and in the Arabic language, regarding those people who possess, those people who have merit, who have fadl, who have fadilat, those people who have good personalities, great personalities, integrity, those who are seen as the leaders of society. And therefore, this group of people are the ones who want this goodness, this greatness, to remain intact and work to counter and to oppose that corruption and that evil which would ruin that greatness. But also baqiyya is a reminder that it's something that's going to remain forever. That it's going to remain baqi. We use it in Urdu as well. That it's going to be baqi, it's going to remain. And this is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about truth and falsehood, وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَّهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا, that the truth has come and the falsehood has gone, and falsehood is thing which would vanish. كَانَ زَهُوقًا, it would vanish. So in the battle between truth and falsehood, truth by itself, you know, this is the great thing about truth, that it doesn't need anybody to hold it up. Haqq doesn't need anybody to hold it up. It stands up by itself. In fact, it helps other people stand up. It doesn't need anybody or anything for it to stand. But it would help other people to stand up, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it will always remain. So truth would always be triumphant. It would always be victorious. It would always remain, whereas falsehood would vanish. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us about this concept because He's telling you and I and everybody who reads the Holy Quran, this is the message, that if you want to remain, then you have to be with the truth. The truth will always remain. If you also want to remain, if you also want to stay baqi, then you'll be with the truth and you would remain. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given an easy solution for that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says, Aliun ma'al haqq wal haqq ma'ali. And he's with the truth, and the truth is Ali. And didn't stop there. He goes further and says, oh Allah, turn the truth whichever way Ali alayhi salatu wasalam turns. So this is the solution. The solution is that, and this is the challenge as well, that can you, can I, can everyone acknowledge that truth? And then the difficult part, act according to that truth. Build a community around that truth, inshallah, which we'll come to in just a moment. But also this baqiya, you'll recall, we have an ayat in the Holy Quran in this same surah, Surah Al-Hud. So it's prior to this. This is verse 116. That is it's in the surah prior. It's in Surah Al-Hud, verse 86. Baqiyatullahi khayrun lakum in kuntum mu'mineen. And when the Imam alayhi salatu wasalam was asked regarding Baqiyatullah, what is Baqiyatullah, then he said that to know that our qa'im, Ajjalallahu ta'ala faraju sharif, salli ala, is baqiyatullah, because the earth will remain because of his existence, and when he reappears, then he would lean on the wall of the Kaaba and recite this verse saying, Baqiyatullahi khayrun lakum in kuntum mu'mineen. Baqiyatullah, that which remains of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is better for you if you are believers. And he will say, Ana Baqiyatullah, I am the remainder of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am the one through which, I am the remainder of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I am the one through which this earth and everything within it remains. And of course, he will fight injustice, he will rid the world of injustice and falsehood and evil, and let virtue prevail. So this verse, in reality, it tells us about the importance of this group of people. These are the group of people who spread the truth, who are involved in reviving the teachings, the message of Islam. They are involved in reviving the message of Ahlul Bayt, as our 8th Holy Imam, Imam Ali ibn Musa Rida alayhi salatu wasalam, says. Rahimallahu man ahya amrana. Mercy be on those who revive our matter. And so companion says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, you'll recall, those of you who are in my majlis on Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, Hussein, you'll recall that I mentioned this hadith that day. That the companion says to the Imam, he says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, but how could we revive your matter? How could we revive your amr? And Imam alayhi salatu wasalam says, your role, your job, your responsibility is to tell people our kalam, our words. Your responsibility is to tell people about us, about what we have said. And if people knew what we had said, then they would have obeyed us, they would have followed us. If people know what we have said, then they would follow us. But like now, as we said, that this is the role and job that we have to tell people about, but we also have to work on our own community, as you've been hearing. And that this person who works on their own community is like the spiritual doctor. The physical doctors, alhamdulillah, we have many of them here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them more tawfiq to serve. And all of you, inshallah ta'ala. The physical doctors look after our physical bodies, and we need them. Without them, if we became ill, we would die, and people used to die in the past because of this. But similarly, we need spiritual doctors in our society as well. So that just as we are concerned about our physical health, about our body's health, we are concerned about the health of our soul as well. In fact, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam says in a narration, he says, I'm surprised that the person who thinks about the food that he eats because he's concerned how it would affect his body, but he's not concerned about the action that he does that would affect his soul. I'm concerned about the food that I put in my body, and I should be. That's how is this going to affect my body? Is it going to make me sick? Is it going to make me unwell? Is it going to give me health problems? But I'm not concerned about the actions that I do in my life, and that is also going to give me a spiritual ailment that's going to harm my soul. The Holy Prophet of Islam is described by Imam Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. In Sermon 108 of Nahjul Balagha, Imam says that the Prophet was like a roaming physician, a roaming doctor, who had ready his ointments and his instruments. He used them wherever the need came to cure the blindness of the hearts, to cure the deafness of the ears, to cure those who were mute. He followed with his medicines the spots of negligence and the places of perplexity, that he would take them away and replace them with irfan, with ma'rifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so each and every community, and in reality we are one community. In reality, followers of Imam Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam are one community. It so happens that we are born in different places in the world, and so we speak different languages, or we have different cultures, or we've become identified through our countries. لِتَعَارَفُ. This is only to identify one another. The Holy Quran says, we divided you into tribes and nations, لِتَعَارَفُ, so that you could identify one another, so that you could recognize one another. So in reality, whether I am Pakistani or Khoja or Iraqi or Iranian, I am one community. If I am the follower of Imam Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, I am one community. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the problem in one community is a problem that affects each and every one of us. And the solutions are one which would affect and would solve the problems of each and every one of us in reality. So when we're talking about building community, and you'll recall I mentioned this previously as well, and that is that building community is taking responsibility. That taking responsibility doesn't mean that I have to have a title or I have to have a position. But no, taking responsibility is the fact that when I come here or I come to any place of worship, then this place of worship is my place of worship. And therefore, I have a responsibility towards it. There's a little, small, minute thing that I notice. Nowadays, in the era of smartphones, we come to the masjid and we think, we'll go to the masjid and I'll charge my phone. It's a minute little thing, tiny thing. But if you're asking me personally, if I go to any place, any masjid, and I've charged my phone, then as a matter of courtesy, nobody's told me to say this. Don't think that, you know, the management told me to say this. No, I'm saying this as a matter of courtesy and personally. No management has asked me to say this. But as a matter of courtesy, if I charged my phone in the masjid, then when I'm leaving and there's a box there of donation, I should put something in there. Because I use the property that belongs to the imam. And similarly, this is a little thing. Similarly, greater than that and more important than that is that when I come here and people serve me, then I should take the opportunity to see and find out that is there an opportunity where I can serve as well. I can help as well. Why? Because whenever you go to all the centers, it's always the same people. So it's the same people who are serving, and so it's the same people who are washing up afterwards when everyone's gone home. You know, because I'm always there to the end so I can see who's there doing the washing up and who's doing the cleaning and who's giving out the food. So if there's an opportunity where I could serve and take that thawab, why should those same people get all the thawab? Why shouldn't I be part of that thawab as well? Why shouldn't I be part of that reward as well? And be part of fixing that community. You know, you see a wheel, intricate wheel, on a car, for example. You know, if that one cog isn't in place, won't work. So every single person in society, even if I think that I'm a very small, insignificant person in society, I'm still important to that society because I'm part of that society. I'm not important because I am me, I'm important because I'm attributed to Imam Amirul Mu'mineen. Recite salawat ala Muhammad. So we have to be part of fixing the society. And the very least that I can do is at least support those people who are calling out the wrong in society, who are propagating the right thing in society, who are saying and telling me and telling people that this is what you need to know and do and believe, and this is what you need to fix. That these are the problems in your society and these are the solutions that you need to get in your society. And the solutions will come when everybody works together, because every single person, like I said, every single person here, from whichever community, whichever ethnic background that I come from, has the same purpose, the same goal, the same end point. Therefore, we are one. Because we have the same goal. And if we don't, then I have to reflect over the fact that why is it that I don't have the same goal? Because that's where the problem is. Maybe that's where the problem is, that I haven't reflected over the fact that every single person who is a follower of Imam Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu salam has the same goal. Recite salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajjil farajhu. So this is the important reminder regarding this verse, that this is what you need to do, identify, and then either be part of the solution or at least assist in being part of the solution. Assist those who are part of the solution. Unfortunately, in every society, there are some kinds of people who exist who neither want to do anything nor do they want anybody else to do anything. The worst kinds of people. But we have to counter that by being people who at least are part of the solution or helping those who are creating the solution. Assisting those, supporting those. Coming and being part of and considering it this my responsibility. Part of my responsibility. This is what I need to do as a person who comes here. How do I do that? Recite salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. How would I do that? One of the examples that's mentioned in another verse, very famous part of the verse. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. This is a very interesting verse, very long verse, part of it which I've recited. Refers to the change in the direction of the Qibla. This verse is about tahwil of Qibla. In that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to ummatan wasata, the balanced nation. Balance, of course, is required in all aspects of our life. Without balance in any aspect, we would be not be able to be successful, not able to progress if there's no balance. In terms of belief, those of you who've been coming to the Tuesday sessions on Aqaid, we mentioned this point as well, that in terms of beliefs, for example, there is a aqidah, a belief regarding jabr, regarding predestination, that everything that the human being does is predestined. As if human beings are robots. Whatever we do is controlled by God. Then there's another aqidah which is counter to that, or it was developed counter to that, which is called tafwid. That means that everything has been delegated to the human being and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not involved in any matter of the human being. So somebody came to Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. So Imam alayhi salam said to him, ask my son, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Manu. And the Imam alayhi salam replied to him, la jabra wa la tafweed walakin amra bayna al-amrayn. There's no predestination. There's no complete predestination. But there's no total free will either. Walakin amra bayna al-amrayn. The matter is in between both of them. That in some matters, in some things, you are predestined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in other matters, you have free will to choose what you can do. So similarly is our life with regards to, this is obviously with regards to our beliefs, but this, our life with regards to our practical lives. And this is really important because a lot of people, for example, who get infatuated with spirituality, they say, for example, we want to go on the spiritual path or we want to become spiritual, right? So how does one become spiritual in Islam? Is it you seclude yourself and go and live in a mountain and don't meet anyone and don't interact with society and just pray and then you'll become spiritual and you'll get spiritual powers? No. Islam says that you have to be balanced. That means that I have to live in this world and be concerned about the worldly matters. But I also have to take care of my spirituality as well. And the same way that I shouldn't engross myself in the worldly matters that I forget the spiritual, similarly I can't let the spirituality overtake my life and forget about the worldly matters. There has to be a balance, even with regards to the prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, famous verse in Surah Al-Isra, at the end of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't recite your prayers loudly, in other words, shouting, nor silently, but follow a matter between the two of them. Right? Similarly, Surah Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about spending. He says, those who, when they're spending, neither are they wasteful, nor are they tight-fisted, but they maintain a matter between these two matters. So balance has to be in everything, whether it's my worldly life, my spirituality, my beliefs, relationship, learning, food, so on and so forth. All of these things are important in my life and they have to be balanced. And it's my challenge, how do I balance all of these things in my life? And of course, Ummatan Wasat refers to, Imam alayhi salatu wasalam says, refers to the Ma'sumeen alayhi salatu wasalam themselves. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam says, we are Ummatan Wasat. And we are the witnesses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over the people, and we are his proofs on this earth. Then he advises in this narration that all followers of mine, be a nation, be a community that balanced, so that the one who has gone ahead will come back to you, and those who are lagging behind would be able to catch up to you. Right? Now, of course, today's day and age, this is the reason why this is particularly important, is because in today's day and age, in every level of society, obviously in the higher levels, you all know that the way that the religion of Islam is portrayed, and even now the way the madhab of the Shia is portrayed, is in the way of extremes. It's portrayed or it's demonstrated as though it's a religion or a practice for those who are extreme, or anybody who practices is somebody who's extreme. Somebody who prays five times a day is not extreme. Five times a day is an obligation on everyone. Anybody who does the wajibat, who stays away from muharramat, this is not extreme. This is the obligation on everybody. But there's a portrayal, there's a implication that that person is extreme. Similarly, in our own societies, in our own communities, we see people with extremist strands who want to impose their thinking, their ways onto other people. Like I said earlier, the kamal of haqq, of truth, it doesn't need anybody to hold it up. If something is true, something is the reality, if something is the haqq, it will stand up by itself. It doesn't need me or you or anybody else to make it stand up. It doesn't need me to force it down your throat. It doesn't need you to force it down my throat. If it's haqq, it will remain. If it's falsehood, it will disappear. No matter how hard I try to pursue it, how hard I try to force it onto somebody else. But Islam, Deen, and Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam are the religion of balance. Neither this extreme nor that extreme. And so, whenever we see extreme in our societies, in our communities, in our groups, in our families, this is what we need to remember. That this is Ummatun Wasat, is Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, and that anything that's taking me towards an extremity, a real extremity, obviously praying five times a day is not an extremity. Doing the wajibat, doing the muharramat, doing what Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam have believed and taught is not an extremity. But those extremities that exist in our society have to be called out by saying we have to return to the way of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. That this verse is a reminder for you, me, and all of us that we have to lead a balanced life, happy life, in order that others might understand and appreciate the balance and wisdom of God's religion as well, inshallah ta'ala. Just a few words before I end regarding the occasions this week. Of course, last week, last Sunday, was the beginning of the new month of Dhul Qa'dah, which is the first day of Dhul Qa'dah, is the day of the Wiladat of Hazrat Fatima Masuma alayha salatu wasalam. Regarding whom there are narrations from four of our Imams alayhi salatu wasalam about her ziyarat. I'll share one narration with you. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam says, that a group of people came to him from Ray. Ray is a place outside of Tehran. And Imam alayhi salam welcomed them and he said, congratulations to the people of Qum. So they said, but Ya Ibn Rasulullah, we are from Ray. Imam alayhi salam repeated, congratulations, felicitations to the people of Qum. Then they said again, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, but we are from Ray. Imam alayhi salam said a third time, felicitations be to the people of Qum. They again said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, but we are from Ray. Imam alayhi salam said, there is a haram for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is at Makkah. And there is a haram for Rasulullah, which is at Medina. And there is a haram for Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, which is at Kufa. And there will be our haram soon. One of my granddaughters would be buried there. Man zaraha wajaba lahu al-jannah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. Whosoever visits her, whosoever goes for her ziyarat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised paradise for that person. Imagine, this is almost Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam is Hazrat Ma'suma's grandfather. This is almost 45 years before she's even born. That Imam alayhi salatu wasalam says, whosoever goes for her ziyarat would go to paradise. Regarding the city of Qom, I mentioned this hadith, I was reading it last night, so I'll share with you. Regarding the city of Qom, it's mentioned that on the Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam narrates, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. I heard from my forefathers that when my grandfather Rasulullah was going for Mi'raj and we passed over various parts of the earth on the journey towards going to the heavens. So he says, when we passed over one of the places, we noticed that there's a place where there is a mountain which is red, Jabal al-Humra, a red mountain. And its color is more brilliant than za'faran, than saffron. And the smell, the scent from it is better than musk. So then my grandfather asked Jibreel, he said, Jibreel, what is this place that is, has this mountain which is so beautiful and the scent is better than musk? So Jibreel replied that this is the place for your Shia and the Shia of Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala. So Rasulullah says, but I noticed there's an old person who's sitting there. Who is that? And of course, we have to mention this, I repeat this every time, that Rasulullah doesn't need to ask Jibreel, but he's asking him so that we know. Rasulullah already knows. So Rasulullah asks Jibreel, he says, who's this old man? So Jibreel says, this is Iblis. So Rasulullah says, if this is the place where for my Shia and the Shia of Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, then Iblis has no place here. So Rasulullah said, Qum, which means stand up and leave. This is why this place is called Qum. This is the hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, regarding our 8th holy Imam, Imam Ali ibn Musa Rida alayhi salatu wasalam, whose birth anniversary is coming next week, I just want to mention one hadith regarding his title Ar-Rida, and then we'll conclude. Somebody came to Imam Muhammad al-Taqi alayhi salatu wasalam. And said to him that people say that this title Ar-Rida, and it's mentioned by historians as well, that this title Ar-Rida is Ar-Rida min Ali Muhammad, the one who was pleased with, or who became pleased with when Ali Muhammad was given to your father by Al-Ma'mun al-Rashid, Khalifa Abbasi. So Imam alayhi salam said, that's no, the people have lied. This is not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this title to my father, Ar-Rida, the one with whom people are pleased. So the person then asked, he said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, then Wasn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased with all the other imams alayhimu salatu wasalam? Right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all the imams alayhimu salam, they were also ar-rida, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was also pleased with them. So why is it that this title was given specifically to your father Imam Ali ibn Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? So Imam alayhi salam replied that the reason is that as far as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned, all of the imams alayhimu salatu wasalam are rida. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with all of them and they were pleased with him. But my father is called ar-rida or was titled ar-rida because in addition with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in addition with a'imma alayhimu salatu wasalam being pleased with him, his followers were also pleased with him and his enemies were also pleased with him. Therefore, the one who his friends, his followers and his enemies, all of them were pleased with him, is called Ar-Rida alayhi salatu wasalam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us recite salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ziyarat of Hazrat Fatima Masuma alayhi salatu wasalam and Imam Ali ibn Musa Rida alayhi salatu wasalam again and again, inshallah ta'ala. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins and the sins of our marhumin and to make us amongst those who are pleased with the Imam alayhi salatu wasalam and Imam is pleased with us. Inna ahsan al hadith وأبلغ الموعظة كتاب الله العلي العظيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم سبحان من سبقت رحمته غضبه وبسط اليدين بالرحمة سبحان من لم يكلف نفسا إلا دون وسعها وعفى عن السيئات ولم يجار بها سبحان من لا يزداد على معاصي العباد إلا كرما وجودا وعلى كثرة الذنوب إلا عفوا وصفحا نشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف على العباد بجوده والعواد وعلى المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين بعثه رحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعم ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة أما سلف من ذنوبكم والإنابة عن الأوزار التي أثقلت ظهوركم فإنه تعالى كريم بكم رؤوف عليكم يقبل اليسير ويعفو عن الكثير قال الله تعالى وقوله الحق توبوا إلى الله توبة نصوحا عسى ربكم أن يكفر عنكم سيئاتكم ويدخلكم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار وقال قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم ألا قد أمركم الله في محكم كتابه بالصلاة على نبيه وحبيبه فقال تعليما لكم وتشريفا لصفيه إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. There's a request to remember all the those who are sick and going through suffering, and especially Sayyid Muzaffar Abbas and all those who are sick and going through suffering. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviate their sickness and give them cure for the sake of Imam Sajjad alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidil Mursaleen wa Shafi'il Mudnibin Nabiyyina Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa alih. وعلى إمام المسلمين وقائد الغر المحجلين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب وعلى سيدة النساء العالمين وبضعة خاتم النبيين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله. وعلى الحسن المجتبى وحسين الشهيد بكربلاء وعلي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي الباقر علم الأولين والآخرين وجعفر بن محمد الصادق الصديق المقتدي بآبائه الصالحين وموسى بن جعفر الكاذب من أولاد النبيين وعلي بن موسى الرضا من إترة بررة المتقين ومحمد بن علي الجواد ولي المؤمنين وعلي بن محمد الهادي إمام الخاشعين والحسن بن علي الزكي العسكري عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا صاحب الزمان ما هي آثار البدء والطغيان هادم بني الشرك والنفاق حاسد فروع البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام اتصل الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرجه وسهل مخرجه واكفل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه وتفضل على أمرائنا المؤمنين بمزيد التوفيقات وإزداد الإقبال وعلو الدرجات. اللهم افعل بنا ما أنت أهله ولا تفعل بنا ما نحن أهله بجاه محمد وآله المعصومين صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفع الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.